the Liquid Lunch. That's who's that? Carly and Mark. Yes, Carly and Mark. That's our music today, and we're here with Kaz Lefave, sci-fi writer. Well, is this your first book?
Yes. My first novel.
First novel. Mm-hmm. You've written nonfiction before, have
no.
you?
No. Well, just as part of work, doing business specifications, technical specifications,
right.
that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But not fiction.
Okay. Great. And so you got your book here. You've actually got a copy here.
Well,
it's
not quite a copy, but it's the prototype.
But it looks good from a distance here.
So it is actually going to be this size. And
which is about, I'm looking at it, probably around 280, 320 pages, something like that.
274, yeah. Okay. 272, yeah. That's pretty close.
You know how you search for a particular page on the book? You don't mind, right?
It's just like Rain Man.
Yeah. You plan to just get to a page, you think, and you feel it, and you go right on it in the first guess. I guess that's the way I was doing it.
Wow. Yeah. Well, that's pretty good. Yeah.
Rain Man, I'm not autistic.
Well, great to have you here, Karen.
Yeah, it's
now,
good to be
here. You've got a really varied background, right?
Mm-hmm.
We mentioned you've got an engineering degree. You've ran a haute couture store in
Amazing.
Yorkville. Mm-hmm. You're a hypnotist and a personal trainer, all this stuff, and yet you've gone ahead and written a book, a sci-fi book.
It's an interesting progression. I've been doing a lot of different things. I guess my interests are varied, and with the haute couture business, that was a big adventure for me, and it just didn't work out. The market wasn't here. So when I closed the store, then I started to evaluate, okay, what am I going to be doing? And as I was going through and learning hypnosis and personal training and doing some reading and development courses, it just started to fall into place.
Mm-hmm.
Because I did write all through my life.
Mm-hmm.
It just wasn't writing was what I was doing. It was just an incidental.
Okay.
And people would say, oh, that's really good. And I go, okay. And just do what I do and then write. So at one point I did get an article published in Fashion in a Sasson magazine. And I wrote that on haute couture. So it was essentially an article on what haute couture is all about.
But I just want to step back just for a second on when you were in the fashion realm of your life. And I probably think that you can still take that with you somewhere as far as, you know, maybe for friends designing or whatever. But was it frustrating in that you're realizing that maybe there wasn't a market for it is a nice way of saying people just are so conditioned to have very bland things or something, or it in terms of they go for this same things, they go to the movie to see a certain movie star as opposed to the story.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the action flicks in the summer. I mean, it's a pattern of a lot of other things. Did it frustrate you at all, or you didn't think of it that way?
Well, the frustration was that I didn't have a name.
Uh-huh.
And at the level I was entering, it was really apparent that I needed a name.
Oh,
so even though I was doing the quality of a Chanel and a Christian Dior and all that, so people didn't recognize it.
Right,
because they weren't familiar with that side of things. They were familiar with the names, but the I guess the more industrial versions of it.
Right, right.
So they're willing to pay thousands of dollars for that,
yeah.
yet not thousands of dollars for something that is workmanship and art.
Right.
And also, I was a little bit out there as far as colors
and
designs. It was very, very architectural, very engineering-like.
Yeah.
So.
Just curious, so you're looking at, you're kind of evaluating all your different options, and you chose to write a book. I mean, you've got the electrical engineering degree.
Mm-hmm.
How come you got out of electrical engineering? I'm just, you know.
Well, I was in computers for 14 years, and after a while, I got to a point where I just wasn't feeling that I was being challenged. I wanted to go to a certain level in industry, and I felt like I had plateaued, and the whole corporate world and that. So, and my creative side was really screaming at me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, get out, do something.
Right.
So I took a year off and decided to write music. So I didn't
publish
anything.
Oh my goodness, music too.
Yeah, I didn't publish anything, but I started writing then. I started
hearing
music and fiddling on the piano. Mm. I'm not a pianist, but enough to get the notes together and put a little demo CD. So went into recording and had a band for 2 weeks and fell apart. I'm really not the front person. I really wanted to write and to be behind the scenes. And and after a year of taking a sabbatical, I ended up going into fashion because I really love costume.
Yeah.
And that's what I wanted to do, is to get into film to do costume.
Yeah.
And so I thought, through the haute couture route, I can build a name for myself and then get into film. So this is just a different approach.
Right.
So what's the game plan here? Is this part of a master strategy?
It's a master strategy.
What's the master plan?
The master plan is I have a series of 10. This is the first in the series. Okay. So I've mapped out the plot line for the series. And from this, I'm also going to fund some water projects because I'm really big on the environment. And I'm starting to funnel my the sales for this mm-hmm. into a foundation.
So now that Harry Potter is finished with all the series, yes. you're trying to come across with something yeah. maybe more adult version than the kids that grow up in
yeah.
that school. You've got this, and hopefully, as I say, there'll be 10 projects, or, well, a big project, 10 yeah. elements to this.
10 elements. Well, I'm hoping yeah. that, because this is sci-fi as opposed to fantasy,
yeah.
I'm hoping that I can bring some of those Harry Potter readers into more of a sci-fi right. world. And a little bit, it's a little bit, J.K. Rowling's amazing, she writes beautifully.
Yeah.
This is a little bit more complex a story, but it's a bit more mature, not
yeah,
for children.
But you know, as far as I know, a lot of the buyers of the books mm-hmm. of Harry Potter were adults. You know, busy office
mm-hmm.
adults.
Yeah,
they
I know. I bought
them. Don't want to go deep because they're too yeah. busy in their busy lives to
right.
read Salman Rushdie. And it was a smart book.
Yeah.
So you had the 12-year-olds, 10-year-olds, and the 44-year-olds reading.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, words are just symbols. So, you know, emotionally, someone can carry over from fantasy to science fiction, I think,
mm-hmm.
very easily.
Well, the only difference is the science fiction is loosely based on science. I don't actually explain
yeah.
what the science is.
Yeah.
So you could think of it as fantasy as you're reading it.
That's right.
Although it's loosely based on science.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned that you're going to start to channel some of the funds from
mm-hmm.
the books into water projects and
mm-hmm.
that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand that the book is about... Well, we should really talk about the title of it. It's
okay.
Nemecene, the Epoch of Redress.
Of Redress.
And you talk about one of the inspirations for the book was your concern for the oceans and for
mm-hmm.
the water of
mm-hmm.
the planet. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, for the past couple of years, friends have been sending me information on, you know, Plastic Island and how our oceanic dead zones are causing the coral reefs to die and all that. So I've been doing some investigation in there. And it's a big thing. I mean, I can't get away from plastics myself. Everything I
yeah.
buy has plastics. Even the organic food I buy, because I buy organic and I'm trying as much to buy no packaging, comes in plastic.
Right.
So I'd like to get some of that book funded for replacement for that as well. Like people who have ideas on replacing plastic with something that's more organic that we can
If we can mention, you know. If we can not be so hard on ourselves too, I'm referring
mm-hmm.
to you and me,
mm-hmm.
Just not do less of and multiply it by billions of people on the planet,
mm-hmm.
Encouraging other people. I remember the comedian Bill Maher on Larry King when it was on was saying, if everyone just stopped buying those SUVs,
mm-hmm.
wouldn't it be so much better with the carbon, da-da-da, and
yeah,
other problems?
Yeah.
Not exactly what you're referring to. Maybe the dead zones and the oceans are caused by other things.
The fertilizers.
But,
you know, if we stop eating so much food or we stop fertilizing all this, putting into our rivers and sending it down and setting the nitrates.
So that's how it's caused. I wasn't even sure myself.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
one cause of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. There are other things. The global warming will aggravate the situation as well.
Right.
So it's all tied in.
Yeah, there's
and
so
that
much.
Scraping by the fishermen, the scraping with the darn things
the anchors,
and ruining
the
coral reefs.
The coral reefs.
Yeah.
yeah. That's more of a mechanical change, right?
Yeah. That's, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So,
I'm really hoping to make a really big difference by,
yeah.
by creating awareness, because this is set in the future on Earth,
right.
where our oceans have died. So the setting is a virulent kind
so
of
So you're
ecosystem.
Talking about like that movie with Mel Gibson when it's that very dismal future. That's when he was younger, when he...
Mad Max.
Yeah,
Mad Max.
Or you had Kevin Costner when they're all living
the water
in
world?
Water world.
It's not the same kind of story.
Yeah.
It's set in that setting, but it's not that kind of
right,
everybody's
exactly.
trying to rip everyone off and kill each other for these small resources. It's not kind of
yeah.
So can
kind
you
of
describe
story,
for a sec what, you know, because you've painted this world in
mm-hmm.
this book. You know, what does a world look like whose oceans are dead?
Well, people are living in protected cities. So there's some protected
the
walls.
The bubble or whatever it is.
Not necessarily a bubble. It's invisible. But they are protected. So they have some sort of filter that will filter the gases coming off the oceans and stop them from being intoxicated. There are other cities that are further up in the highlands which aren't the protection isn't as needed because they're not near the oceans. It's near the coastal lands that where all the problems come.
Yeah.
The cities are also, there's a network of cooling generators keeping the planet cool. So there's a cycle that's going on and regenerating the noxious gases into something that can be used as a coolant. So they've found a way to recycle and use that. There's other things about the tide of the planet. The planet has very high tides. So there's certain things that they have to do to make sure that the city.
So you've taken things that people are projecting somewhat. Certain scientists are projecting today.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't do da 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 da, mm-hmm. this is what can happen to us. And you're taking actually real things and taking to, well, this is what. Here's the world, a fictional world that mm-hmm. could be true, with those things, those elements in.
Yeah.
So you're actually applying those elements, not just making it up.
I'm applying them and then adding my own
of course,
interpretation
you have to.
Of it. Yes,
but there is some.
There
of
is.
It.
A, I've done a lot of research on, say, weather patterns. I mean, I'm not sure if they're exact, but you know, the fog patterns and how that happens.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, the cities, the way the cultures are together. Of course, there's one humanity. Everyone after several iterations of disasters had to pull together. So then there's that aspect of it, the politics of it. The church and the state are no longer separate.
Yeah,
finally.
It's together. Finally.
Good.
And all the problems that causes as well. So there's that aspect underlying, and then there's that spiritual aspect underneath it. So the PSI is a physical, spiritual, and intellectual fiction. It's not. It's just.
Is this a one area on the planet that you're using as a sample in the story, or is it the whole world together?
This
here?
Particular one is one city.
Okay.
And the main characters are traveling from their hometown to the city in the beginning, but it's set in that one city. The series is set across the world.
Oh, I see.
So we're just starting with this one city. Okay. The story develops right there.
And
what
the
city
reader,
is it?
It's called Edinburgh.
It's not a real city?
It is a real city that will be divulged later, or
okay.
divulged later.
Okay.
I'm planning to have some dialogue going with my readers, saying, what do you think this is? And what do you think? Where do you think this is? And that kind of thing as the series progresses.
Sure. One of my very favorite writers today mm-hmm. is from Japan, Murakami Haruki,
mm-hmm.
and he was encouraged to finally go home and write a novel when he was watching a baseball game. Someone hit a grand slam home run in Tokyo, mm-hmm. and it just flashed as they went down. Wrote his thing. Someone told me, a 23-year-old told me that she's read all his books, and by the time you read all his books, there's certain little mystery things that only tie together like the puzzle
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
until you read them all.
Mm-hmm.
That's you?
That's what I'm doing.
Okay.
I'm hoping I can pull that off, but that's how I've written this. So there are certain sections that seem a little vague.
Yeah.
Or if you read it now and then you read book number 4 and you go back to read it, then you might say read it differently.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the attempt. We will see. Uh-huh.
So have you written any of the other ones yet, or parts of any of the other of the series?
Or maybe
I have scenes mm-hmm. where I've moved things around. I have the outlines and what the storyline will be in each, what's going to be, because it's a one big story that has to flow and change.
Mm-hmm.
So I know who the characters are, the main characters, how they're going to change throughout the story till mm-hmm. story number 10. Mm-hmm. So it's laid out. And as I was writing this, I also made sure that, okay, how is this going to affect the other? So I have files and files of notes where I put that note down and make sure it coincides with what the big picture is.
Steve, not that I'm a fan of Stephen King, but he is a good writer, and he's mm-hmm. read all the great writers. And he had a car accident, and he thought, okay, I'll write a book to give some people some advice on writing. And basically was like, don't follow too many rules on writing, just write.
I bought his book and read it.
Oh, you did? But wasn't there a section in that where he says, don't be too tight with your outline for the novel? I'm just saying that because
mm-hmm.
he was encouraging to, you want to write it like you're reading it for the first time yourself. You have a scene, things
uh-huh.
happen, then react.
Uh-huh.
And be welcoming, changing things as they go. And I think you were hinting, you got a sort of thing outlined, but you got things, and you know where you can keep track, and you got your notes and files, but you can change things as they develop.
It was very interesting because I, as an engineer and an analytical, I like to have everything all set out.
Yeah.
So I set out my outline, and at one point I said, I have to start writing. So I started writing, and as I was writing, things would come and that weren't in the outline, and they would just come, and I went, okay, let's go for it.
Yeah, sure.
And they just happened to fit, because I knew the stories, what I wanted. They would just come when I was in that zone, and then I go, oh, this is okay, I'll use that, and then I'd throw out a scene and put it somewhere else. That
There's
won't
that
go.
There's energy within us or something that's so powerful that comes out, and you got to welcome it, I think.
Yeah, what is that? I mean, some people say it's almost like you channeling.
A channeling.
And I find the same thing writing music.
Oh, you write music, Hugh.
Yeah. Yes. But I find that often what you get at the end is you look back and you go, wow, I couldn't have done all that. I must have had some help along the way.
Yeah.
You know? What do you think that is?
Oh, I think they were tapping into our
the
universe there. So we're tapping into something.
Yeah.
I don't take credit for my creativity. It comes, and I know it comes early in the morning. Mm-hmm. And certain times when I'm really, and it just comes. I get things and they pop. So what I do is I just write them down right away, because they'll just leave.
It's allowing them in. A lot of us, the problem with a lot of people out there here in big cities, Toronto for sure, is we're so tight. We don't allow this beautiful stuff to channel into us.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's good that you're doing that. This, you're welcoming this when you're
learning. Yeah, it's pretty exciting, because you say, well, where did that come from?
Yeah.
And by not owning it, it's great, because then you don't want to get as attached to the criticism of it as well. Like it's a stretch, but once you get used to that, it's cool.
So we get a little bit of help as artists.
Yeah.
In the creative process a little bit. But what about what about the Earth itself and the environment and the oceans?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're obviously facing some sort of some challenges around all that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think there's help for that as well? Beyond us getting some help on the personal level, is there help for the world, for the global environment?
If we're open to ideas and getting out of our own heads, the answers will come to us. But I think we do have to move fast. That's just my opinion. I think we're going to reach a tipping point that's going to be pretty scary. So right now, that's just my personal opinion. We're a bit in denial that this is not affecting the world. But we live in a bubble, and the bubble's only so big.
Yeah.
And we're filling it up with junk. So something's going to happen.
You just walk in the malls. It is people, guys that that almost run me over in these overly gigantic cars, and you say, well, why are you riding that in the first place? And they just, you know, I mean, what are you talking about?
They shouldn't be driving cars in the mall.
That's right, right in the mall. I meant the parking. Excuse me, I didn't go into the details. But thanks for that clarification. Yeah, I mean, I mean, right next door, there's people that are, it's like we're right next to people. I feel more connected to people from other countries. I never met them before. They hardly speak English. And let's say I'm visiting in another country.
Mm-hmm.
But we're just zoned into the same thing so well. And the person that is in the same city all their lives are so, they're so strangers to me. They're just so different. And one of them is just total denial of things that are dangerous to the environment. It just blows my mind.
It's because we don't see it. It gets pushed out. I mean, all the water goes into this one area, Plastic Island. Everything goes down there. So we don't see it.
Yeah.
So it all ends up in one little spot of the world. And they think, but it's all connected. So eventually it
interdependency. They don't realize this.
Yeah.
So do you talk, when you say Plastic Island, is that big thing in the middle of the Pacific where all the plastic has accumulated?
Yeah, it accumulates. And it's in the water, and all these little flakes look like fish food. And the fish are eating, they're getting confused because it looks like plankton or something. And they've taken samples of the water where they can see that there's so much plastic in there. It actually looks like it's just food.
Mm.
It's pretty disgusting, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And and then we eat that, and it passes up the food chain. So
sounds pretty horrible.
Yeah.
It looks like we're going to have you back to talk about all that other stuff.
Well,
are you hopeful, Karen, or are you just hoping that this book might be able to have some sort of effect and raise awareness?
Well, I'm hopeful because there are more people who are starting to talk, and there's going to be a point where we're going to be a big enough voice that we're going to be the tipping point as well. Like, it's that energy of mind that's going to kind of tip us over, and then we'll do something about it.
But what will we do?
I don't know what we will do.
It's one thing to raise awareness. It's another thing to actually, now that you're aware, do something, right? But what can we do?
What can we do? Well, we can essentially don't drive in more SUVs. We can not buy things that are sold in plastic and look for alternatives. We can do that. We can, but what to do that, we have to go against the grain and the big money behind all of that as well.
I think so also as an
it's just us as consumers. Sorry, I mean us who's going to have to talk as opposed to let the businesses.
What do you think about this? Also, it's called that little pep talk thing, more than a pep talk to get people aware.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed there's even in Ontario a version of this, but Burning Man Festival in the salt flats that once a year the people get together,
mm-hmm.
and they create this artificial town. Have you heard of that?
It's called
Burning Man Festival.
Burning Man Festival.
Oh, well, I'll talk to you after
okay,
the show.
Sure.
But it's quite a great, where people get together with like-minded, like what you're talking about.
Okay.
And they create, they have to bring their own water, they have to bring their own things in a total flat desert thing and have this temporary festival for four days.
Festival.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hugh, you've heard of it too.
I know.
Yeah.
And of course, then there's the Burning Book
is it?
Festival. Right?
Oh, you're we wouldn't want that.
No.
Toss them
no,
on
no,
the
no.
fire.
No.
Yeah.
Okay, and now you've got an opening coming up, right?
Yeah.
You've got, you're going to, a book launch coming up
next
week? I have
a book launch next week at the Gladstone Hotel. It's Wednesday the 21st.
Well, beautiful venue. Very beautiful venue.
Yeah.
Beautiful place.
Yeah. It's really nice. So we'll be in the ballroom expecting 150 people.
Yeah.
And also have a goal by November 4th to sell 3,000 copies so I can start the funding, like 3,000 or more.
Caviar
copies.
And shrimp and whatever?
Not for, no. No. It won't be caviar and shrimp. No seafood.
Whale meat.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Little snippets and stuff.
Yeah, whale meat. Okay, wonderful. So what time does that start on the 21st?
6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. And there'll be a reading, there'll be some munchies, some music, and book signing. And
nice.
Yeah.
That's going to be a great thing.
It will.
Now, this is your first sci-fi book,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any favorite sci-fi writers that, you know, for all the sci-fi people out there, you know, because there's people that they just follow the whole sci-fi thing.
Uh-huh.
They read Locus magazine.
Okay.
Do you subscribe to Locus?
Well, interestingly enough, I watch sci-fi movies, but I don't read sci-fi.
Oh, okay.
I read more self-development, spiritual, universe time, new age, that kind of stuff. And all reading for learning, like languages and marketing. But for the movies I watch, I will watch. So, okay. I like, my favorite series would be Firefly. Only real sci-fi Firefly people will know what that is. I love the Star Wars series.
Of course.
I like the other ones that are sci-fi. The Star Wars, there's a whole series of that. There's it's not coming to me.
Which one?
SGI.
Describe it.
SGI series.
Now, do you ever imagine this book being turned into a movie?
Or
a series?
A movie. Movies, yes.
Ten movies, yes. Yeah.
I'm writing the screenplay in the fall. I'll be my next part, is to get this into movies.
Yeah. Okay. Well, listen, we're looking mm-hmm. forward to that. And we're looking forward to the opening next Wednesday.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How can people, do they need to get tickets? Or
they can go online.
Yeah?
They can go to www.nemecene.com. So that's N-E-M-E-C-E. ne.com, and they can register there, and And that's how they can do that.
So they can register for the opening there. Yep. Can they also order a book?
They can order a book online as well. It'll get shipped to them.
Okay,
so,
great.
So they'll pre-order because it's going to be ready in a couple of days. So I'm going to get the books in a couple of days. Yeah.
Okay, great. So, yeah. Well, listen, we look forward to seeing you there next Wednesday. So congratulations on having
thank
the book
much.
Written.
Well, thank you for having me.
And we look forward to having you on before Fareed Zakaria grabs you on CNN and George Noori on Coast to Coast, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay. Thanks, Karen.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Hugh. Thanks, Daniel.
Karen Lefave, Nemecene, The Epoch of Redress. Okay, Dan, let's take a little break, we're going to come back with Bahman Yazdanfar, leader of the Canadians' Choice Party. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Karen Lefave, author of the compelling, exciting, and thrilling first novel of a new 10-novel sci-fi series called Nemecene, The Epoch of Redress, a futuristic view of life on Earth after massive environmental changes. Please join me September 21st at the Gladstone Hotel in Toronto for the launch. Register or pre-order a copy at nemecene.com. That's N-E-M-E-C-E-N-E. A minimum of 10% of all profits for the entire series are funding global water projects. It all starts here.